Judge number 4, Sri Lanka. Judge number 5, Poland.
Welcome back to the Karen Demirchyan Sports Complex in Yerevan, Armenia, and to the AIBA Youth World Championships. It's semi-final day. We had 10 earlier on. We now know the makeup of tomorrow's finals at light flyweight, bantamweight, light welterweight, middleweight, and also heavyweight. This evening, it is the turn of the flyweights, lightweights, welterweights, light heavyweights, and super heavyweights. And the first bout to get us underway at flyweight at 52 kilos. Involves Javier Cintron of Puerto Rico in the red corner. And in the blue corner is Jorge Cordero of Cuba. It's the second Puerto Rico-Cuba bout we've had today. The first one at bantamweight, Sir Alexis Guibert beat Freddy Ortiz. Cintron was ready to make his ring entrance about 7 or 8 minutes ago. Standing, waiting patiently as the bell goes for the start of the first round. Cintron, London Olympian, beats Masaya Kobayashi of Japan, 26-14 in his previous bout. Cordero beat Dhiraj of India, 11-8. Both fighters boxing out of southpaw stance. Seen a lot of southpaw so far today. Cintron looking for that left hand early, good three punch combination for Cordero. A scoring punch, of course, can be landed with either hand, but the knuckle part of the glove has got to land cleanly without deflection or any kind of blocking on the front or sides of the head or body, above the belt, of course, to count. Five judges at ringside will score each round. Three scores for each fighter are selected at the end of each round, and the three closest scores are the ones selected. Again, looking to go to the body there, Cordero, certainly more than Cintron is at the moment. And quite a lot of action in this first round. Often it can be a getting to know you process, with both fighters just trying to find the weaknesses in their opponents. Made to miss with the left hand there, Cordero, but got his guard back up nice and tight and high again quickly. Cuba's pedigree in amateur boxing, of course. Well, second to none, really. One of their all-time greats, Teofilo Stevenson, unfortunately passed away relatively recently, three-time Olympic gold medalist. Could have been more if Cuba hadn't chosen not to participate in a couple more games that he would have been available for. does put a weight of expectation on any young Cuban fighter. Most all the competitors in this competition are 17 or 18 years old. You have to have been born in 94 or 95 to qualify. The scores at the end of the first round put it 5-3 in favour of Puerto Rico. You see a 9 in there for Cordero. That would not have been one of the three selected scores. The cleaner work there, as we could see, coming from Javier Cintron. And just to explain what I mean by the three closest scores, if a fighter was scored by the five judges at the end of a round with scores of 3, 4, 4, 4, and 5, then the 3 4s would be taken. It's not always going to be that simple, of course. If he was scored as a 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, for example, then the 4, the 5, and the 6 would be taken. What it does do is eliminate, really, for want of a better phrase, rogue scores, possibly, might be one way of putting it. Cuba had two boxers through earlier on, not just Alexis Guibert, but also Kevin Brown, who defeated English Joshua Kelly. Again, a good flurry of punches there, three of them in total by Cordero, but they were caught on the gloves and the elbows. Again, he's trying to work away to the body, but he springs into action there, Cintron. Bit of a slap there from Cordero with a slightly overhand left. And down to the body. Little shake of the head there from Cordero briefly. And as he went in with that left hand, he may have been caught there with a left of Cintron's and a right possibly just squeezes between the guard. I think one of those will have scored, a combination of right and left. He's picking his shots well and then covering back up again very quickly, and he gets some weight behind that left hand as well, the backhand for a southpaw. And that's a good example there of his defensive technique. It's very difficult for Cordero to get any of these punches through, and of course in letting them go he does run the risk of leaving himself slightly exposed. That was a good left hand, though, from Cordero. Free just insisting that the two fighters take a step back, and that was a very good start once they re-engage from Cintron. Just having a little bit more success here, Cordero. That was a nice right hand as well, which certainly found the target. He's maybe just growing into this contest a little bit, getting to grips with his opponent, working out a way to make things work. That's the interesting thing about all levels of amateur boxing, is a lot of the time, almost all of the time, they will not have seen each other fight. They will not know each other's styles. You have to adapt as the rounds go on. And somebody who may look like they're in the ascendancy early on as the fight goes on may not appear to be so, although it's another round for the Puerto Rican, but only by the 1 point this time, so 10-7. Got those scorecards, a 7 and a 6 in there for Cintron. three, a five, and a five as well. So the 6, 5, and 5 would have scored out of those five scores, just to give you an example of what I've been talking about. 15 divided by 3 isn't quite 5, but it's less than 5.5, and so it's rounded down.
Second down.
And it's Cordero, really, who needs to come out and throw here. But that brings difficulties of its own. Chasing a deficit is always a difficult thing to do. At the best of times, that was a nice left hand, though, which shook Sintron a little bit and made him miss as well as he tried to counter. Nice boxing from Sintron, swayed out of the way of the left hand and then came back with a right. Cordero just beginning to slap a little bit with that left hand at times. And as I mentioned, the punches have got to come with the knuckle part of the glove, and I think that might have been the left hand into the right hand side of the head guard of Sintron. They've got to come with the business part of the glove, otherwise they don't count. Some good leverage on the uppercut from Sintron, but Cordero had his guard intact. It may have been breached on that occasion, though. Into the final round of the contest, and Sintron is certainly not of a mind to try and just find the space in the ring and keep at distance. He wants to try and engage. Nice combination from Sintron. And it looks like he is going to get one back for Puerto Rico. After his teammate Freddy Ortiz lost earlier on. So we count down the final few seconds of the bout. 10-7 it was going into the start of the third round. And he certainly feels he's got it there, Sintron. But he'll have to wait a little while yet. You can never be absolutely sure. Results are in, and it does go to the red corner indeed, and he won that third round 5-4 as well, so 15-11 overall to Javier Sintron, so he progresses to tomorrow's final. And you look at those scores for the final round, 4-point advantage. Two of which he opened up in the opening round.
Boat number 3.
It's a good crisp work from him. He did try and work off that southpaw jab just a little bit more maybe than Jorge Cordero did. And that was a nice counter as he just slipped out of the way of the left hand and came back with a ride of his own. And did keep the pressure on coming forwards, throwing volumes of punches to drive him back towards the ropes. And just as Puerto Rico against Cuba can be a fierce rivalry, so can the next bout we've got up here, which sees Oliver Simpson of England take on Kurt Walker of Ireland. We had some great battles during the London 2012 Olympics. You look back to Katie Taylor against Tasha Jonas, which the Irish woman won, of course, on her way to Olympic gold. She will actually be in Yerevan, if she's not here already, to pick up an award at tomorrow night's award ceremony, four-time AIBA world champion. Oliver Simpson beating Sencer Onat of Turkey in his last bout. There's also Luke Campbell against Jonjo Nevin in their final, which saw Campbell win gold. Kurt Walker representing Ireland in the blue corner. It can always be a little bit special, this. Samuel Kistahuri from France is the one who's running closest there. Other than that, he's been in relative control of most of the bouts he's had so far this week. Ian Clark Bautista of the Philippines, who he beat by a 7-point margin in the last round, was a President's Cup silver medalist. But Tenji's Onat of Turkey was a Junior World Championship silver medalist, so they both got rid of good opposition in the last round. They touched gloves before the start of these three-minute rounds as a number of the Irish team sat behind me here to cheer their man on. Walker, quite considerably the taller of the two, both with an orthodox stance. And the call from behind me is for Walker to wait for Simpson to try and draw that lead and catch him on the way in, possibly. He does have that height and reach advantage. Trying to establish that jab, maybe. Very cagey, this, at the moment. Left hand could have scored there from Simpson on the inside. Simpson trying to get in a little bit closer. He does wave that lead left hand. Walker is always on the move, as if he's about to snap it out at any second. Both of these two boxers bouncing on the balls of their feet. There's a lot of energy being expended in there, even though there aren't all that many meaningful punches being thrown. Again, Simpson trying to get in close, but when he does, Walker does seem able to catch him with a single shot when he's trying to work his way through to the inside. Walker, the one Irish fighter through to the semi-final stage. That was a good left to the body there from Simpson. Two English fighters here in action this morning, both lost. Daniel Williams at heavyweight, Josh Kelly at light welterweight. Huey Lewis Fury is in action later in the super heavyweights. Everybody who fights today, of course, is guaranteed a bronze medal. Flurry of punches from Simpson again as he managed to get into range and avoid catching that left-hand lead on the way in. But that was a good combination again from the Englishman. Now, how have the judges scored this as we reach the end of round one? 4-3 to Oliver Simpson is the verdict. Well, those three threes for Walker will be the scores that were selected for him. There was a seven in there. Saw briefly on the top line for Simpson. That seven won't have played a part in the overall scoring. As he tries to get to the inside there, Simpson, Walker just drops a short right hand right onto the middle of his face as he tries to come in. So they hold those gloves up high. Westing gloves, 10 ounces. So just the 1 point down at the moment, the Irishman. This is tight, as we thought it might well be. Lead left hand for Walker, moving all over the place. He always looks as though he's just poised to throw that left hand. He skips into range and then skips back out again, looking to feint with the feet every now and again, Walker. Although it's not strictly a feint, it's just a move forward followed by a swift back pedal. Simpson again trying to get in close, which is what he needs to do really to score points. He looks a tidy, compact boxer, Oliver Simpson. He's up against a tall flyweight here. That was good, crisp work again there from Simpson though. Throws two or three shots to the body, but he dropped his elbows nicely there, Walker. Being the height he is, you'd imagine that he may well be a little bit vulnerable to the body. Getting those elbows down in time to catch the punches of a shorter boxer as he gets in and out nicely there, Simpson. Got two or three punches away and then just swayed out of the way. Vociferous support for Walker from the Irish team behind me. We'll have to see if that's been translated into points by the end of this round, but there's been some intelligent boxing from Simpson. Walker trying to cut off the ring as much as he can for Simpson, trying to back him into one of those corners, as he has done now. Well, the end of round two, and that has gone 5-2 in the Englishman's favour. So Simpson now 9-5 ahead. It's the 7, the 7 and the 5 that will score for Simpson there, those two threes. So 9-5 at the end of the second round. Actually, it would have been the 7, 5, and 3 that would have scored for Simpson in that round. The 3 selected scores. I was bound to make a mistake in my calculations at some point, I suppose. So he's really got it all to do in this final round, Walker. And this may well play into Simpson's hands. Already seen Javier Cintron of Puerto Rico make it through to the flyweight final. Walker trying to apply some pressure here to Simpson, but he's calm in defence. Putting Simpson under as much pressure as he can, but the guard again is tight, taking most of those on the gloves and on the forearms. He's putting in a lot of effort here, Walker. It'll be interesting to see how long he can sustain this for. Over a minute into the final round, he needs to keep the work rate and the tempo up as high as he possibly can. Well, he is without doubt the aggressor here, Walker, but I'm not sure how much of an impact this onslaught is having, really. Simpson isn't having an enormous amount of trouble with it. Moving around the ring. Four points is a big deficit to claw back in a final round. Well, that was a scoring punch as Simpson was trying to retreat. He was caught with the right hand. Well, this is a tremendous effort by Walker. 3 minutes is a long time to sustain this kind of salvo, and he's doing it well. And maybe that left hand got through as well. This could be tight into the last 30 seconds. Simpson throwing a couple of punches there himself. Maybe thinks that he needs to land one more to be absolutely sure here. They'll be aware of the scores between rounds. The judges won't know. The referee won't know. The corners do know. And at the bell, the two fighters embrace, and I don't think either one is sure. He had a 4-point lead going into the final round, Oliver Simpson. And we'll just have to wait and see how that final 3 minutes was interpreted by those five judges ringside. It would be a tremendous comeback by Walker if he's managed to turn it around. And he couldn't have done any more. Simpson doesn't look particularly out of breath. He's blowing a little bit harder there, Walker. He's pacing around a little bit nervously as well. Which way has it gone?
The winner is in the red corner.
And it is Simpson. He did get some points back in that final round there, Walker. He won it 7-5, but it wasn't quite enough. So 14-12 to Oliver Simpson in the end. And he really had to survivor onslaught in that final round. 10 points given to both fighters by one judge, 9 by another. So that testifies to the amount of leather that was being thrown in there. 14-12. Simpson, though, goes through to the flyweight final, where he will face Javier Cintron of Puerto Rico. A lot of action in that final round. One of the most entertaining bouts we've seen so far today, I would say. Now we move up into the lightweights now, 60 kilos. That in the red corner is Raul Curiel of Mexico. One of the younger boxers in the competition. Seventeen today, Raul Curiel. And he'll be hoping it's a happy birthday against Venezuela's Luis Torres. There's his record. Big win against Edward Cheeseman, wide margin that, 27 points to 16. A National Olympiad bronze medalist, Luis Torres, 18 years old. He's actually 19 on the 2nd of January, so the age gap between these two is about as big as it could get, to be honest. Had a walkover in the opening round, which is always welcome. Beat Slovakia's Michal Zatorski 14-7. He's a youth national champion. All boxers who compete in the AIBA Youth World Championships have to be born in 1994 or 1995. So the vast majority of them are 17 when they arrive at this competition. Not all of them, though. Obviously, Curiel wasn't. Wouter Jokic of the Netherlands, who got knocked out at the quarter-final stage, doesn't turn 17 until the 27th of December. So there is that advantage in age here for Torres, but they both look to be very similar kind of builds. They are, of course, in the same weight category, but that doesn't always mean that they are exactly the same size. Backpedaling there, Torres with a right hand. Stepping out the jab with the left as well. And then backpedaling. Curiel, the only Mexican to make it through to the semi-final stages. There were high hopes for their champion Diego De La Hoya at bantamweight. Hasn't worked out for him this time around. And Torres, the only Venezuelan. Good combination put together by Curiel. If anything, just slightly taller than Torres. Misses with a rather wild left hand. Nice right hand there that time though from Curiel. He's looking to work to the body, start off with the body and then throw hooks left and right. I've had all day yesterday to think about this contest and how they're going to approach it. And the first round is always so very, very crucial as we tick down to the end of it now. Any kind of a lead surrendered can be very difficult to get back. And it's absolutely level, 4-4. Well, 3-4s in each of the scorecards, and they'll have been the three scores taken. The three scores selected been talking about the scoring system. It is actually changing next year. Five judges scoring out of 10, more in line with the professional system. Winner will get 10 points, the loser of the round will get 9. There will be an extra point for a knockdown, so if you lose a round and on knockdown, then it'll be a 10-8 round, is the terminology. And 3 of those 5 scorecards will be randomly selected at the end of each round. So this scoring system not in place for all that much longer. The new one will be in play for the Amateur World Championships in Kazakhstan next October, I'm told. Well, again, this is something you often see. If there's too much moisture, too much water on the head guard, on the face, on the chest, then the referee will get the fighter towel down before the start of the round. Good evasive work there from Torres, just swaying out of the way of the left hand. And pushed around a touch there by Curiel, but not to any great effect. And that was a nice left hand straight down the middle. Flick out that southpaw jab there, Torres. Holds his hands a little bit low, backs off the distance. That low hands is quite an unusual sight in amateur boxing. But he really only does it when he feels at least that he's out of range. Trust his reflexes to keep him safe, as you can see there. But then at close quarters, when he knows that the punches can land, he gets that guard up tight and high. Piles in a punch to the body, Torres. Volume of punches being thrown by both fighters is impressive. There's been non-stop action, really, since the start of the first round. It's impressive stuff in this second round from the blue corner from Torres of Venezuela. His style is, well, you would say in a way more of a professional style, as I mentioned, that low slung guard at times. Does trust those reflexes to keep him clear. Puts together a number of punches and stays on the inside. Stays where he is for quite a long time sometimes. He was caught by one there, maybe a couple. Does hold his feet a bit more than you're used to seeing from amateur boxers. Well, it was 4 apiece in the first round. And what have we got at the end of the second? Well, it's 5 apiece this time, so 9-9, and this is really as tight as it gets so far, and it's not because it's been cagey either. They've both been throwing plenty of punches, some fairly varying score lines there for Raul Curiel, all very consistent for the Venezuelan Luis Torres. A 10 and a 9 in there for Curiel, a 6, a 4 and a 6, so it's the 6, a 4 and a 6 that will have been used. 4 5s and a 4. For Torres, so I'm sure you can work that one out. And with his style, Torres, he will get caught. But it is a good style to watch, that's for sure. And it'll be interesting to see how both of these two approach it. You wouldn't exactly say either has been overcautious so far, and they'll know that they are level going into the final round. It may cause them to be a little bit more cautious, although it doesn't look like it so far. And just a slight problem with the head guard there, with Raul Kuril. Just needs to get tightened at the back slightly, alerting the referee's attention to it, that it had come just a little bit loose. Safety, of course, of the fighters is paramount at all times. Referee ordering the fighters to break and just having a little word in the ear of Torres, who was hanging on a little bit in there. And they may now both be beginning to feel the pace. And that was a nice left hand from Torres that just snapped the head back of Kuriel a little bit as he tried to move in behind his own right. I'm not even going to try and pick this. Nothing to split them in the first couple of rounds. Bending at the waist too much there, Torres. That was what the referee was telling him. Again, a great slip with those hands low, just using his feet to get out of the way. And a nice right uppercut as well from the man in blue. And that may well have scored a flurry of punches in there as well. And I think one of those might have got through. Oh, but he was caught there. That was a nice right hand from Kuriel. Draw some applause from the crowd. And they're both really piling it on in the final seconds. There's still 35, 36 seconds remaining. Might not sound like long, but if you're in there, it is. And this could be absolutely crucial. Whoever wins these final exchanges could win the fight, and they both know it. They both know how tight it was going into the final round. They both know that the chance to fight for gold is on the line here. They're both guaranteed a bronze, but neither wants a bronze. Neither wants to settle for a bronze. Not when they can come back tomorrow and go for the ultimate prize. Well, that was a really absorbing contest, and both of them raised their hands in celebration at the end, but I really couldn't tell you who's won that. We're just going to have to wait for the decision. There was a bit of joy from the corner of Luis Torres as well, of Venezuela. They feel that their man has got it, but they can't be 100% sure. Raul Kuriel, turning 17 today, put in a really good performance there against a boxer who... he's not far away from being 2 years older than him.
The winner is in the red corner.
And it's gone to Kuriel, and the Venezuelans can't quite believe it in their corner. They can't quite believe it, but good sportsmanship. The two embrace in the ring, and Kuriel has done it. 15-13, so he took that final round 6-4. Well, that is a tremendous effort from the young man. And he will come back tomorrow and box for a Youth World Boxing Championship gold medal against one of these next two fighters, and we're going to see in a second. But just some action from what was a pulsating final round. And Torres thought he got it, he really thought he got it. And Curiel will be up against either Sofyan Umiha of France. He's in the red corner. Had an overwhelming victory in his last fight. 25-7 he won against Malik Montgomery of the USA. Look at that, 24-7 against Serhii Bochechuk of the Ukraine. So he's not really been pushed at all so far. Hussein Baysangarov of Russia will very much be hoping to push him. His last fight against Yassin Yilmaz of Turkey was stopped by the referee. He's in the blue corner. Three fighters from Russia have made it through to the finals already. The referee stopped the contest in round two. Already this morning, Magomed Rashid Jabrailov, who got a walkover, actually didn't even need to box to get through. Magomed Madiev and Andrei Skotsky are through for Russia, so having brought five boxers into the semi-finals already, three of them have progressed. And it's three out of three, too. Umiha, the only representative from France in the semi-final, 17 years old. Baysangarov, 18. So both fighters with an orthodox stance. Baysangarov just inching forward little by little, looking to try and work his way into punching range. Keeps that guard high, happy to take punches on the gloves and forearms. Just to slowly walk his man down by the look of it. He tries to get Umiha on the run. Support you can hear is for Sofyan Umiha. Got a lot of backing in the crowd behind me. That was a neat little short uppercut, though, from Baysangarov. Left hand from Umiha as he moved away. Looked to sneak between the guard. Sangrov alternating between the body and the head, or at least trying to. Made a miss there though by Umiha. Again, no sooner has Umiha moved away than by Sangarov is quick to try and cut down the space, cut down that gap, and get right back up close and personal. A little bit wild there from Baysangarov. It's been a tight opening round, or at least that's the way it's looked from where I'm sitting. Nice left hand from Baysangarov to finish it off with. And it's gone 4-2 in the Russian's favour. Some boos behind me from his supporters. Three fours and three twos. And those the scores that count. Choosing not to take the stool in the corner by Sangarov. Saw his fellow countryman Magomed Madiev do that earlier on as well. And he wants to get inside as much as he can by Sangarov. Miha is the man who's looking to use the space in that ring. Trying to just drop back onto that back foot. And start his punches a little bit further back. The referee just indicating that that may have been bordering on being a little low. He doesn't want to get too close to Baysangarov, and I think that's what his corner were trying to suggest to him between rounds. He can't spend all of his time boxing at range. At the same time, getting right in there is exactly where Baysangarov wants him, although he does get through with a nice right hand of his own there, but Baysangarov had landed his just seconds before. Slightly different feel to the fight now in the second round. Nice uppercut there from Baysangarov. The crowd starting to get involved. The arena beginning to fill up. It'll be rocking later. There are two Armenian fighters in action. Then we get to the light heavyweights and the super heavyweights. Sangarov just biding his time a little bit more here. And that was a nice left hand, and that's where he feels most comfortable. Miha trying to engage at that kind of distance is going to come off second best. Again, short uppercut from the Russian. Didn't travel far, didn't travel any great power either, but it did land. And he won't want to be the odd man out, having seen all his teammates win this afternoon. He wants to be back tomorrow alongside them as well again. Letting that uppercut go. Tick down to the end of the second. And he's level, well, he's not level, but he's narrowed the gap there. back to just 1.65 to Amiha in that second round. Given 11 points by one of the judges. It's a 7, a 5 and a 6 that score. The other judge giving him a 3 as well in there, so some very varying ones for that round for Umiha. But he's got it back to just the 1 point deficit going into the third. Both fighters quick to the middle of the ring and they touch gloves at the start of the round and the referee tells them off. The rules are strict. You touch gloves at the start of the contest. You do not touch gloves at any other point. It is in, literally, is in the rule book. I know that because I've got it in front of me. Miha would have taken encouragement from that last round, certainly. Baysangarov didn't really do anything different in round two than he did in round one, and the Frenchman did slightly, I would say. Looking for the left hand and again the right uppercut, and it's a punch he really favours by Sangarov. It's just whether it's getting through or not. It looks good from here. And again he throws one and then dips under the right hand. That was a good left hand from Umiha. That landed. His corner encouraging him to come in behind that punch rather than just throw and then move. Just hold his feet on the inside. It's that split second longer to allow him to get one, maybe two more punches away and then get on his bike. Midway through the final round, and this is going to be very, very tight. That was maybe round the back of the head, and that's what the referee is signalling. It did land, but it's got to be on the front or the side. You can't hit round the back. Sangarov seems to have tightened up a little bit more in the last few seconds. That right to the body, I think, may well have scored for Umiha, and this is down to the wire now, down to the very, very sharp end. And they have to keep their concentration. Any kind of a lapse and you can give the contest away. If you get too reckless because you feel you're behind, then it may turn out that the scoring wasn't going exactly as you thought it was. You have to stick to the game plan and the method you have in your mind. And that takes some doing. When there is a place in the AIBA Youth World Championships on the line. Well, 9-8 it was going into the end of the contest in favour of Baysangarov. He just waved a glove there on the way back to his corner. It wasn't a very convincing celebration. He looks a little bit downcast there, Umiha. Maybe he feels he hasn't quite done enough. He's had some big, big wins in this competition. By some wide margins. If he wins this one, it will be tight. Sangarov looks very confident. And he does get the decision, and it is tight though. 16-14, he took that final round just by a single point. Goes through by a couple.
Well, the 7, the 5 and the 6 counting for Stefan Umiha. And there's people crowding around the monitor in front of me wanting to see exactly how that final round was scored. There are boos from the French supporters, but they're always going to be. Some really good exchanges in there. Now we move on to the next bout. This one at 69 kilograms at welterweight between Zhidi Zhang of China from the Jiangsu province and Akmalbek Kosimov of Uzbekistan. Many people's favourite. Zhidi Zhang, though, 2 times national champion. And Zhang beat Valter Djokic, the youngest competitor in the competition, by 3 points in the previous round. Look at his record, Eitsan Shleyev, he beat in the quarterfinals, who was a Klitschko Brothers youth tournament winner by quite a wide margin as well, 16-9. Both of these fighters 18 years old. Zhidi Zhang in the red corner. Kosimov, Akmazbek in the blue corner. Both might have scored there, almost hitting each other simultaneously. Neat little uppercut rather from Akmazbek. Got 2 southpaws in there by the look of it. Both with right hand leads. Haven't seen all that much switching so far today. We saw a little bit of it in the very first fight of the afternoon from the Philippines, Jade Bornea. Zhang looking for the body with the right and then with the left hand and then pushing his opponent away. He'll have to be a little bit careful about that. Powerful looking left hand again to the body from Zhang, who started well. Again, looking for that punch to the body. It is hard to tell with body shots, though, whether they're landing or whether they're catching the elbow and the forearms first. Again, he throws it, but if he's tucking that elbow down there, Kosimov, Akmazbek, and it does look like he is, then he may well be blocking those. They're eye-catching. It's up to the judges at ringside to decide, and there's another good example of it, whether that is landing cleanly or whether it isn't. And that is what makes it such a difficult job. Little combination there from Akmazbek for the first time, really. He looks for it every single time, but Akmazbek is really not exposing too much of his rib cage or kidney area, if any at all. That left hand, that backhand from Zhang. That was a nice left hand. Bounced off the forehead of Zhang, who again, leading with that right, goes to the body with the left. There's not too much variation from him so far. Akmazbek maybe just beginning to warm to his task. It's taking a little while to have a look with the Chinaman and see if he can work out a way through. He does bow his head a little bit when he tucks up with that guard. Zhang leaves that forehead exposed somewhat. And that's what he's looking for. Good example of it there from Akmazbek. And it's 7-4 to the man from Uzbekistan at the end of that first round. 4 points going to China. And I would say that the majority of those points for Akmazbek were scored later on in the round when he came out of his shell a little bit and started to throw almost exclusively to the head of Zhang. That was a nice shot from Zhang there, though. But just there, as he was covering up behind his guard, he can tend to sink a little bit low and almost stops looking at what's in front of him. A 3-point lead at the start of a second round is a healthy position to be in, and I think what we can surmise from that scoring as well is that those left hands that are thundering into the left-hand side, the right-hand side rather, of Akmazbek's body are catching the elbow first. He is covering up well. Zhang just looking to feint with his feet. There's plenty of spite, plenty of venom behind these punches. Everyone he throws, he really puts 100% into. He's well organised, Akmazbek. Just a little word with Zhang for pulling around the back of the head. Left to the body, could have scored there for Zhang again. He looks to put everything in behind that left hand. Springs out of that tight guard to let the right hand go there, Akmazbek, but it was an immediate response from Zhang. Use of the shoulder, strictly prohibited. Again, point being made by the referee. Haven't seen any warnings today. If a warning is issued to either fighter, then his opponent is awarded 2 points. Nice left hand from Akmazbek. Three warnings and you're disqualified. Told to keep his head up, Zhang, as well. Mentioned that when he's in defensive mode, he does tend to stare down at his feet a little bit. Nice uppercut there from Akmazbek. Bell goes at the end of the second round, and he's really narrowed the gap there. He takes a second round, 5-3. The Chinaman, it means it's 10-9 to Akmazbek. And it was Zhang who had the tighter contest last time out. As I mentioned, beating Wouter Jokic of the Netherlands 11-8. And there was a left to the body that maybe did score. A little bit off balance as he came in behind his right hand there. Well, it's seesawed this one so far. At the end of the first round, Akmazbek was 7-4 up. Won it by a clear 3 points, but Zhang turning things around to win round two by 2 points. A bit more purpose about Akmazbek as he comes out for this third round. He knows that he just took his foot off the gas in that second round. Right hand from the Uzbek. Left hand caught by the gloves. Throws in that left to the body again, Zhang. Right hand made its way through. That was a good punch. Akmazbek was on his way in. Zhang slipped it and then replied with the right. Big bomb of a left hand goes over the top, but it's a mixture of shoulder and head guard. Midway through the final round, and once again, this is very, very tight. Exaggerated movement from Zhang. Good energy at this stage of the fight to be able to produce that kind of footwork. Good little dip at the knees to get out of the way of that right hand as well. And he's maybe finishing slightly the stronger here, Zhang. Point down. At the end of the second, 10-9. But he's had a good final round, at least according to my eyes. And I think he might have done enough here. And just warned for hitting around the back of the body. Akmazbek himself just admonished by the referee for pushing down on his opponent. And the referee telling them to engage, but there's only a few seconds left. I don't think there'll be another meaningful punch thrown, and there isn't as the bell goes. And it's going to be fascinating to see the scoring of that third round. Zhang had more energy. He was coming forward more, he was making the running more, but that doesn't always translate into a better score. Akmazbek looks confident in the blue corner, doesn't he? Smiles from Zhang as well. They both certainly put everything they had into that. And it's Uzbekistan who's got it. He increased his lead in the final round. Akmazbek winning it by 7 points to 5 to go through 17-14. And just consistently higher scoring across all five judges. Well, Zhang threw plenty of punches in the final round. Mazbek clearly had his measure. Referee's ready for the next bout. The second semi-final at welterweight, 69 kilo category, and Kosimov Akmazbek will be up against either Artem Soloviov of the Ukraine. He had a narrow win last time out against Paisith Froom of Australia, 13-12. James Dickey retired against him in his previous contest. Or he could be in with Osman Aydin of Turkey. Five-point victory against Andrei Mikhailov of Bulgaria in his previous contest. One of the Ukraine's finest will be in town alongside Katie Taylor tomorrow night for the awards. Olympic and world champion Alexander Usyk is going to be with us as well. Sure, he'd have some words of advice for his compatriot. He's 18 years old, Aydin 17. Slight late adjustment to the head guard there of Aydin. Some support for Turkey in the house. Ukraine got a boxer through to a final earlier on today. That was Alexander Kishniak. He beat Dalet Bagabatov in the middleweight contest. Overhand right sailed over Aydin's head from Soloviov. Nice jab from Aydin as he tries to back his man up into the corner. Just as they broke there, a left hand from Soloviov. Whistle past the chin of Aydin. Little bit of an untidy fight so far. Soloviov keen to get in close, almost to rest his shoulder on the head of Aydin, and that's what he's been told about by the referee now. It's not something you can really do in amateur boxing. That was a nice left hand from Soloviov. Aydin circling, trying to cut off the ring for Soloviov. He's an awkward customer, the Turk. Seems happy enough to take a punch to give a couple. gets that guard in place and looks to try and walk forward, was letting fly with the right uppercut there. Thought there may have been a slight suggestion he was just holding around the back of the head slightly with his left hand. And at the end of the first round, it's 5-3 in favour of Artem Soloviov. And consistently higher scoring across the five judges. Aiden scoring just 1 point from two judges, three from the other three. Aiden trying to get that right hand down the middle. Again, Aiden rushes in. Soloviov ends up on the canvas. The referee just making sure that he's okay. Might have been a little bit of use of the shoulder there from Osman Aiden. He's an untidy customer. It's difficult for the referee, really, to work out exactly what's going on when they get in at close quarters like that. Again, now the Turkish man trying to get in as close as he can. That brings a response from Soloviov, who I think is growing a little bit tired of the, I wouldn't say antics, and the Turkish fighter just a little bit tired of his style, maybe. Trying to break three and find himself a little bit of space. It's fairly relentless there from Aiden in the second round so far. Working away to the body, trying to throw uppercuts through that guard. He knows that he needs to redress the balance. He's trailing 5-3 after the first round. Being behind after the first round of a three-round contest, even if it's by a single point, puts doubts in a boxer's mind. It'll make him feel inevitably that something needs to change, whether it's in terms of the work rate, the energy, or the tactics. Good tight guard from Aiden. He's trying to pop that uppercut through. His right foot just came off the canvas as he threw it. Really pivoting and put his weight through his hip there as he tried to get everything he could underneath it. Certainly been the aggressor. He's always been the fighter coming forward, Osman Aiden. And again, just walks straight up on Soloviov, straight into him almost. Nice little combination there, though, from the Ukraine man. And a good left hand. I think that would have scored. You're never given a moment's peace when you're in there with Osman Aiden, that's for sure. And that round is scored a draw at 5 points each. So he maintains his 2-point lead. A little bit of accompanying music pipes up in the background. There's more of a Turkish feel to it than the Ukrainian one, in my experience anyway. And that's where he likes to be. He likes to get onto the inside as much as he possibly can, Aiden. And he's not all that bothered a lot of the time about exactly how he gets there. If it means almost stumbling into his opponent with that guard held high, then that's what he does. It makes it difficult for Solovyov. You don't encounter this kind of style all that much in amateur boxing. Into the third and final round. Aiden again coming forward. The left hand looked like it might have caught the point of the chin. Right hand almost landed on the back of the head there of Solovyov from Aiden. And Solovyov just tried to turn him and get away from the ropes and get himself out of trouble. Both corners absolutely absorbed by this. Managed to slip underneath that right hand and let loose a left of his own, Aiden. Solovyov making a little bit of use of the shoulder there, according to the referee. There was an uppercut in the middle of all of that from Aiden. Midway point of the final round. A two-point advantage Solovyov took into this. Solovyov maybe beginning to look a little bit weary in there now. And every time the referee issues the instruction to box, the guard goes up and Aiden just walks forward. He's been pushed back there though. Right hand from Solovyov. Might just have sneaked through the guard. Head up towards the last 30 seconds. These final exchanges could be so very, very important. Who is going to make it through to face Kozimov Akmazbek of Uzbekistan? Aiden trying to finish strongly, throwing a lot of punches, but that was good work from Solovyov. He managed to get out of the way of all of them as the bell goes. No celebrations from the Ukrainian. He was 2 points up going into that final round. That is too narrow to be singing and dancing. It was a pretty tight final round as well. Osman Aiden is spent. Everybody had a rest day yesterday after Tuesday's quarterfinals. The batteries fully recharged, allow them to put every ounce of effort into today's encounters. Now let's see whose hand is going to be raised.
The winner is in the red corner.
From the red corner, it is the Ukrainian, Solovyov. And again, he maintained that two-point lead. The third round was scored five apiece, as was the second round. So it was that two-point advantage he opened up in the first round that has got Artem Solovyov through to the final in the welterweight category tomorrow, where he will face Kozimov Akmazbek of Uzbekistan.
Court number 344, please come to the ring. Red court is represented by Georgia. Blue court is represented by Scotland.
Well, I've spoken earlier about the difficulties of turning round a defeat, if you like, in the first round. And Aiden just couldn't do it. It certainly wasn't for lack of effort. And we've got the light heavyweights now, 81 kilogram category. That is Alexander Dokvadze of Georgia, a European junior champion. He's unbeaten this year. And that was the draw for this particular weight category. Radmov disqualified in their first bout. That would have gone down well with the crowd here. He's an Azerbaijani. The two things that the home crowd have stuck to is cheering their own and booing their neighbours. Scott Forrest from Scotland is the opponent. Tight win against Dilmurod Sadabalayev of the Ukraine in the last round. A stoppage in the first contest on his list there. He will be the underdog in this one, but that won't bother him one bit. Forrest, a slightly taller man out of the two. The only Scot to make it through to the semi-finals. All action start to the fight. Right hand sneaking through there from Dokvadze, possibly. Uppercut as well from the Georgian. May have found the target, as I mentioned, unbeaten this year. Success breeds confidence, breeds more success. Forrest does like to try and work behind that jab. He's trying to keep Dokvadze a little bit of range. As we saw in that opening exchange, he does like to get up close and work on the inside more. Forrest showing that he's capable of doing that as well. But more orthodox in style, if you like. More for the purist, flicking out that jab where possible. Great weight behind the punches from Dokvadze. That was a good uppercut there from Forrest. The right hand. And a nice left jab flicked out there as well as Dokvadze tried to close in and go for the 1-2 of his own. Interesting opening round this without being overly aggressive. Both of these have thrown a lot of punches. Tactically, maybe Forrest so far has been slightly the cuter. Made to miss there, Dokvadze, on a couple of occasions by Forrest. Good evasive work. Good variety from both fighters in there as well. Combination of body and headshots, and it's 3-2 to the Scot in the blue corner. He'll be happy about the colour he's got today. Doc Vadsey wouldn't be against the red either, with a single point advantage to Forrest at the end of round one. And that's the kind of position really that Doc Vadsey wants to get Forrest into, backed up against the ropes, and then he can work away with left and right hand. But he covers up well there, as you can see, and there was one occasion where in the midst of one of those kind of melees he just snapped out a left hand and found the target. Good start to the round from Doc Vadsey. Flurry of punches. I think at least one of them may have scored there. Forrest quick to try and get out of that clinch. Forrest again, flicking out the jab. May have walked onto a right hand there, though, from Doc Vadsey. The Georgian just occupying the centre of the ring, never moving too far away from it. Forrest tending to circle him rather than the other way round. It's a fairly standard-sized ring. Parameters can vary, at least they can in professional boxing. I was in Liverpool last Friday. Watched David Price, bronze medalist at the Beijing Olympics. That was an enormous ring for his British and Commonwealth title defences against Matt Skelton. But when you're 6'9", you probably need one. Interestingly, Price saying in the build-up to that fight to me that he regrets the way he approached his semi-final in the Olympics. He felt that he was a little, not complacent, but that he took his foot off the gas maybe, knowing that he'd already got a bronze. And that's the position that both of these two find themselves in. Every fighter has done so far today. You get to the semi-finals in boxing and you know that you've got a bronze medal. But you also know that if you win, you get the chance to fight for gold. But psychologically, as Price pointed out, it can have an effect. Subconsciously, possibly, whichever way you want to look at it. Whichever camp you're in when it comes to things like mental preparation, but I don't think we've seen anybody during the course of today's bouts do anything other than leave it all in the ring. So a single point advantage for Scott Forrest at the end of the first. What have we got at the end of the second? And it's exactly the same score again. 3-2 for the second round as well as the first round. So 6-4 now to Forrest. A 6 in there for Doc Vadsey, but it's the 3-2s that would have scored. 3-3s scored by 3 out of the 5 judges for Forrest. And that's how they arrived at the 3-2 verdict. Nice left hand there, just clipped the side of Doc Vadsey's head. There's not any great weight behind the punches from either fighter, to be honest, in this fight so far. The left hand just sneaking through the guard there from the Georgian. And Forrest corner, I'm sure, will just be telling him more of the same. In the Georgian corner, they'll presumably have had to have come up with something a little bit different. A short right hand on the back foot there from Forrest. It was well timed. Look, Vance is coming forward a bit more now. As I said previously, he tended to occupy the centre of the ring and not quite let Forrest come to him. But now he's really hunting his man down. That's very well done by Forrest to turn him there. He was backed up onto the ropes. He spun Doc Vadsley round. And he's being ushered to the neutral corner there. There's a bit of blood coming from a cut beneath his right eye there for Scott Forrest. Doesn't look too bad. More of a scratch, really, more than a cut. Referee keeping his eye on everything. I don't think it's going to bother him. But fights can be stopped on cuts, of course. Referee stops a contest through an injury. And Forrest will just be ever so slightly aware of it. He'll know that some damage has been done. He won't really be able to tell quite how bad. Good work rate there from Doc Vadsley. And then Forrest planting a right hand into the midriff. And again, I think there might be a little bit of blood coming from the nose there as well, possibly. But it's the cut underneath the eye they're looking at, and there is a bit of blood from the nose as well. So he's been in the wars in this final round. Some cotton buds trying to staunch that flow of blood. And these will be anxious times for Scott Forrest. He'll know all about the referee stops contest through injury rule. In terms of his ability to continue, he's absolutely able. But he won't want either of those two to worsen. I don't think he's going to have any kind of problem with the blood coming from the nose, but it's just whether that cut gets any worse. It doesn't look to have got any worse to me. At first glance, it didn't look deep or serious, but that's a good combination of punches there from Doc Vadsley. A couple of those straight into the face of Scott Forrest, and he's really letting them go now. Just a 2-point advantage going into the final round, and that could have disappeared. Forrest may be looking the slightly more tired of the two as we go right into the final few seconds. Doc Vadsley as well, you can see from his punches there, they're hardly reaching. He's feeling this too, building up of lactic acid in the limbs of both of these fighters. And still throwing them though. Maybe one of those could have scored in the final few seconds if he could have got one or maybe two of those through. 3-2, 3-2 in rounds one and rounds two to Scott Forrest. And they're just taking care of those two slight injuries, you'd have to describe them as, in the blue corner. He looks absolutely shattered there, Doc Vadsley, as he makes his way to the centre of the ring. Scott Forrest, pale skin and red hair, could only really be from one place. And it is Scotland who gets it, and he's won that third round very convincingly there, Scott Forrest. 7-3 he took it to stretch a four-point lead to a six-point lead to go through 13-7. The three sevens from three of the five judges doing the damage. And that is a very good performance. So Scotland will have a finalist tomorrow at light heavyweight. And you can get ready for the noise volume increasing in the background, because entering the ring now is the second semi-final light heavyweight, and that is between Idris Shakhmanov of Russia, aiming to become the fifth Russian today out of five to get to his final. But they're not cheering for him. John McDonnery beat in his last fight. He's had three comfortable wins. 7 points, 10 points, and 8 points. The noise is very much for him. Nikol Aryutyunov from Armenia. Aryutyunov, born in Russia but to Armenian parents, got past England's Steve Woodall 12-7 and has had comfortable wins himself. Got a bronze at the Klitschko Brothers tournament. Started boxing 2006, has had 100 bouts since then. Mariusz Gorny is the man who will have to make sure everything goes as it should. The third man in the ring. And there are the five judges: Kazakhstan, Algeria, England, Ireland, and Argentina. A lot of pressure on Aryutyunov here, but as you can see from the scorecards from his previous bouts, he's not letting it get to him. And this is what the home crowd have been waiting for today. They've got another one of their own coming a little bit later in Narek Melkonyan at super heavyweight. This again at light heavyweight. 81 kilograms, the winner going through to face Scotland's Scott Forrest. Aryutyunov, by some distance, the taller of the two. And every punch that he throws that lands anywhere on Shakhmanov will be cheered to the rafters. But it's been a very successful day for Russia so far. It's been a very successful couple of weeks for Russia so far. Careful to try and stay at distance, try and stay away Aryutyunov's jab, and then when it does fire out, get underneath it and try and come in on the inside. He does have the reach, Aryutyunov, but what you would say about that jab is it's not exactly a ramrod jab. He is tall at the weight. Just lunging forward a bit clumsily as he tried to score to the body. I suspect we might see quite a lot of that, him trying to score to the body, that is, not necessarily lunging forward clumsily. pretty tight opening round. Again, lunges in. Shakhmanov, that was a nice left hand though from Aratianov. Snapped back the head of his opponent. He hasn't found a way to get on the inside that effectively yet, Shakhmanov. As we go into the final few seconds. And the first round goes to Armenia by a score of 5-2, as you can probably tell from the cheers in the background. Three fives from three of the five judges. Two fives scored by Shakhmanov, but two twos and a three as well, so they're the ones that would have counted. And he is spearing him on the end of that jab. As I said, it's not really all that potent a weapon in terms of hurting an opponent, but it is a good weapon in terms of scoring points, and that is what it's all about. So a very good start for the home man. He just pushed his opponent away. He had a quick look over his shoulder there, Shakhmanov, at the referee. Right hand may have got through. Threw it to the body, then up to the head. There's quite a distance separating them on the physique of Aratianov. They would dearly love a gold medalist. The Karen Demirchyan Sports Complex, which is where we are, held the 2009 Junior World Championships, and they had a great return on that occasion. One gold, two silvers, four bronzes for Armenian fighters. Cuffing left hand. Right hand as well. And a flurry of punches. And this is good stuff from Aratianov. Good stuff. Being warned for hitting with the inside part of his glove. Slapping, as some like to call it. If you want to land a scoring shot, you've got to land it with the knuckle part of the glove. He's told to watch his head there. Aratianov, he does tend to crouch a little bit in that stance, doesn't make completely full use of that height. Crowd certainly will put an extra spring in his step. It can work for the other man as well, of course. Shakhmanov may be feeding off this, but that was a nice left hand, and that seemed to have him just slightly staggered there for a second. Shakhmanov, it certainly set him off balance. Shakhmanov really is being picked off here by Aratianov. There isn't much variation, there isn't an awful lot of guile in his attacks. He's coming forward in straight lines really, swinging big punches at the Armenian. And we'll have to see how this second round is scored, but it's not really working. He's got to try and find some angles, got to try and move from side to side. Because if he stands there, that is what will keep happening. The jab comes out again from Aratianov, and again it finds the face of Shakhmanov. Well, 7-3 the second round, 12-5 now. Aratianov leads, and you can't really argue with it on the basis of what we've just seen, I wouldn't say. He's getting picked off at range, Shakhmanov. One of the judges gave Aritsianov 10 there. 2 sevens and a six he got from three of the others are the ones that give him his score. Unloading with those right hands. And he covers up well. And then that's a nice short right. And that was a lovely punch with the left. And then he scored maybe two more there in that flurry. That was a great exchange for him. And then again with another left hand as we go into the start of the third round. Well, it's his to throw away now. Seven-point lead. It's huge. Shakhmanov has got to really get him going here. Maybe even stop him. You'd see a couple of eight counts in the final contest of the afternoon session between Pavel Vidzbicki and Daniel Williams, one apiece. Of course, 2 8 counts in a round. And you've lost 3 8 counts during the course of the three rounds, and you've lost as well. Different at senior level, takes three in a round to stop someone, four in a contest overall. I don't think there's any serious chance of that happening here, but those are the rules as they stand. But that's the kind of thing that Shakhmanov needs. And he has to just go for broke here. The simplifying thing as he gets caught by a right hand about having a 7 point deficit is that you really can throw everything at it. You may as well lose by 12 as lose by 7. If it's tight, of course, you don't want to be too reckless in case you give your opponent unnecessary openings. But he has got to stop Aritsianov. Looks like Shakhmanov is going to become the first Russian not to win his semi-final today. The other four have made it through, and he looks weary in there now. A right and then a left make contact into the last minute. And if anything, Aritsianov is stretching his lead in this final round. He's been convincing in the competition so far, and that hasn't changed. This contest, he does look a little bit ungainly at times, but that is due to being tall for the weight. That right hand didn't land as much as the crowd thought it did, but then the follow-up left did. Trying to throw some punches off the back foot. Wild swing and a miss from Shakhmanov, and he is absolutely spent. He's almost out on his feet. Only a few seconds left, still comes forward, still throwing the punches, still hoping that one of them can knock his opponent down. It's not going to happen. There'll be a big roar when the bell goes. We'll have to wait and see how that final round was scored, but I don't think there's any serious possibility. Well, I know there isn't any serious possibility of there being anything other than a blue arm raised at the end of this. Shakhmanov did everything he could, but he's just been beaten by a better man. As we knew it would be, and it's by a wide, wide margin as well. 19 points to 9. Taking that final round, 7 points to 4. And this crowd in the Karen Demirchyan Sports Complex in the Yerevan, very happy with that one. They've got another one of their own to come in a few minutes' time. Aritsianov will be up against Scott Forrest of Scotland, who will have to take on the atmosphere as well as the man in the opposite corner. Now we move up to the super heavyweights, 91 kilos and above. The final two bouts of the evening session, the final two bouts of the semi-finals, and their details of them both. Narek Melkonyan of Armenia up against Huey Fury of England. And there is Narendra of India. Good win against Russia's Ivan Kabatov. ...19 points to 9, it was a wide margin. Two times youth national champion of Russia, Kabatov. Narendra, as you can see in the blue corner, still waiting for Florian Schulz of Germany. Quite sure what the delay is. I can see him in the far side of the arena still waiting to make his ring walk, with Narendra standing there poised and ready for action. And the winner has been announced as Narendra from India, Florian Schulz of Germany, presumably has withdrawn. And the fighter I can see in the far side of the arena in the red is the man who was wearing red in the next contest, Huey Fury. So it's a walkover for Narendra of India, who will go straight through to the final without having to throw a punch. And he'll take that. Had a day off yesterday, he gets another day off today. It looked on the far side as though there was somebody ready to come in and make his way to the red corner, and indeed there is, but it's for the next bout, and it's the English boxer Huey Fury. And there'll be another cracking atmosphere for this one as well. And Fury, Melkonyan on their way to the ring. Huey Fury beat Kanagat Akhmadov of Kazakhstan 15-5 in his previous bout. One of the Manchester Furies. The boxing dynasty of sorts being founded up there, Tyson Fury at heavyweight in a professional game. And he's had convincing wins so far, Huey Fury. Tyson, of course, beat Kevin Kingpin Johnson in Belfast a couple of Saturdays ago in a WBC eliminator. A lot of headlines around him. It'll be interesting to see if they're similar in style. Narek Melkonyan, though, in the blue corner, has had some closer contests. Last time out beating Josip Granic of Croatia 14-8. And of course, all the support behind Melkonyan. The referee from Ireland is Michael Gallagher. Huey Fury trained actually by Peter Fury, who's also the trainer of Tyson Fury. none of that will count for anything over the next three-minute rounds. Fury starting strongly, throwing a couple of punches to the body. He wants to try and gain some momentum early on and maybe just try and quieten down this home crowd. And that is not going to be an easy thing to do. Melkonyan a bit more circumspect in the opening few seconds, just covering up southpaw. Leading with that right hand. So a bit of a clash of styles here possibly. Fury carries that left a bit low. Trying to snap out the jab, doubles the jab and then comes in with the right hand. Melkonyan hasn't really found his range yet. The punches aren't quite reaching. The stance is a little wide at times. Limits his mobility somewhat. Fury looks nice and sharp here. Got one competitor through to a final earlier on. Oliver Simpson beating Ireland's Kurt Walker. It's their fourth boxer through to the semi-finals. Couple lost in the afternoon session. Circling around Melkonyan, and despite the fact that that left is almost permanently held at around about waist height and the right isn't exactly high either, Melkonyan hasn't been able to take advantage of it at all. But how have the judges seen it? Well, it's 2-1 to England, according to them. 2-1 to the red corner. Three twos in that scorecard for Fury. Three single points for Melkonyan. And he's blowing a bit in the corner there. It was a bit untidy at times. Fury looked, in many ways, the more purposeful, the boxer who had maybe a clear idea of how he was going to go about this. But as often is the way when orthodox clashes with southpaw, that's exactly what happens. They clash. And it's difficult for either boxer to land any really clean punches, and clean punches, of course, being what it is all about. Nice right hand for Fury. How many of these are getting through the guard? That one certainly didn't. that left hand might have done as he tries to turn Melkonyan. Hit him on the back slightly in the process. Fury switches from the head down to the body. Melkonyan does come in with his head down sometimes. And that's exactly, again, what the referee is warning him about. They're almost exactly the same height. But Fury stands tall. Melkonyan does tend to crouch. That was a nice punch with the right hand from Fury. Doesn't stay there long when he gets a shot away. And again, just bending at the waist and ducking really, Melkonyan. Needs a shoulder up into the midriff of Fury, which the referee won't allow. Melkonyan trying to get that right hand lead of his to work. Fury's coped fairly well with the southpaw opponent so far. Really loaded up with the right hand to the body, but it won't have scored. A little bit ragged there from the Englishman. Well, that was a great right hand. That got through the guard. There was no doubt about that. And it's a standing eight count from the referee, Michael Gallagher. And I think he's right to give it. The right head went crashing through. And you could see the head shudder as he took it. There's no extra point for it. It's a single scoring shot, but it really had an impact there. And in that second round, he's extended his lead. That was a very good round for Fury. 5-2, so 7-3 overall now. And he's just gradually dominating this fight. Melkonyan is finding it difficult to come up with any answers. Just flicking out that left hand, just trying to find the range. That's what that is all about, is he just feels really his way towards his opponent, and he found the range perfectly. We didn't see it there, but the right hand that necessitated the eight count from Michael Gallagher really was a nice punch. There was plenty behind it as well. Melkonyan took it well. And he comes out all guns blazing at the start of the third, and he's got to. Again, Fiori just taking a step back. He's happy to box off the back foot, almost with that cross guard at times. I haven't seen anybody hold their hands as low as he has all day long. But it's a method that seems to suit him well. He doesn't neglect his defence. He just generally tries to stay out of range. Pointed towards a neutral corner. And again, he's just having a word. And he's taking a point, actually, the referee, Michael Gallagher. That's a warning. And rather, a warning will mean that 2 points will be added to the score of Huey Fiori. But warned for continued use of the head 3 times. You can caution someone, the third caution turns into a first warning, and that's what we just saw there. So you do get punished for it if you pick one up. 2 free points to the man in front of you, and that really has sealed this. I don't think there was any possibility, to be honest, that Melkonyan could have turned it round anyway, but he certainly can't now. Taking a point, of course, is a professional boxing term. More heavily punished for it in the amateur game. Good left hand though there from Melkonyan as he traps Fiori in a corner. But unless he can somehow stop the Englishman, then it is going to be Fiori who will go through to the final at super heavyweight to meet Narendra, who didn't have to throw a punch against Germany's Florian Schulz. German competitor Omar El Hag also withdrew from his bout at bantamweight this afternoon. Disappointing to see. Box your way to a semi-final. I don't know the reason, I must admit. As we enter the closing stages, maybe some muted celebrations from Fiori when the bell goes. He will know that he has done more than enough here. Won the first round 2-1, won the second 5-2, and will, I think, have won that final round, and I think would have won it without the 2 points he got courtesy of the warning given to Melkonyan. The referee wastes no time in getting them both to the centre of the squared circle, as some like to call it. The four corners of truth. And of course it is Fiori who takes it. And he takes the final round 6-2, so wins 13-5. A scoreline that may have been slightly inflated. Well, of course, has been slightly inflated by the fact that he was given 2 free points in that final round, courtesy of the warning for use of the head from Melkonyan. And so that completes today's action in the semi-finals. 20 contests we had. There'll be 10 tomorrow. Russia's day, really. They had 5 fighters through to the semi-finals. 4 of them have made it through to go for gold tomorrow. The closing stages of this bout. Melkonyan just couldn't quite repeat the success that we saw at light heavyweight from his fellow countryman Nikol Aritsianov. And Fiori joins his compatriot Oliver Simpson in the finals tomorrow. Didn't get to see Narendra today. won his bout against Schultz, as mentioned, by walkover. Well, there's been plenty of good action from the Karen Demirchyan Sports Complex in Yerevan, the capital of Armenia today, as the AIBA Youth World Championships continue apace. Tomorrow will be the final day. I'm Andy Clark. I hope you very much enjoy the fight this afternoon. I certainly have, and we'll be back for more tomorrow.